to a baby girl called Ursula Santor. She was born, it is said, with a hunched back, but she was also a very, very clever young lady. At the age of 5, she went to the medieval equivalent of school. She left school at 15. At the age of 20, she got married to a carpenter by the name of Tobias Shipton. But by this time, she was having visions about the future, and news of her prophecies was starting to spread. There was a lot of superstition about her. She was already learning to hate authority, and some people thought she was a witch. There was a bridge at the entrance to the park. Now, Mother Shipton said, "When the high bridge in Knaresborough has fallen thrice, the end of the world is nigh. Not to get you worried, it has been down twice already, but there are more roadworks across that bridge than anywhere else in this area, and I can assure you it's very solid."
We'll never know which of the many, many stories about Mother Shipton's life were actually true. She's a folk legend. And unless the laws of physics have changed in the last few centuries, she couldn't actually see the future. But the pool that turns objects to stone? Well, that is real. And at some point, a few centuries ago, some enterprising local decided to start charging admission.
This park used to belong to the royal family. It was bought by Sir Charles Slingsby from King Charles I in 1630. Sir Charles was a canny Yorkshireman who decided a pretty penny could be made from this place. Hence, guided tours commenced here in that year. Not me, I have to add. Before he bought this, it had a very, very bad press. People being superstitious would find animal skeletons, leaves turning to stone, and they actually thought people would turn to stone. He soon realised he was onto a good thing here. The waters consist of iron, zinc, magnesium, aluminium, calcium carbonate. There's a stream which is underground, and it comes to the surface just before you come down to this well. It comes to the surface, it goes over the well head, and when it drops down, it'll turn anything to stone because of the various chemicals it's picked up. And the peak became known as a health cure. People would bathe in the water and drink the water. It is supposed to cure rheumatism. It's not recommendable today with modern health and safety.
This isn't true petrification. The material isn't being replaced with stone. But at the risk of making some chemists angry at me, I think it's close enough. The water here is so rich in minerals, carbonates and sulfates that it acts like stalactites forming in a cave or limescale building up on your plumbing. The teddy bears, the hats, the whatever's in here, it's steadily being coated in minerals over and over and over again. And if it's porous, it becomes solid enough that, yeah, it turns to stone. Chemically, maybe not. Linguistically, sure, I'll take that.
Now, with regard to the objects that you see up there, it's got to be anything porous. The smaller the object is, the shorter time it takes. A teddy would take about 3 months. Anything bigger would take 6 months to a year. It does freeze in winter. Icicles come right down to the floor, and it's quite spectacular. It's been flowing since the Ice Age. The other remarkable thing about the water is it flows at the same rate all the time, 700 gallons an hour. It never varies, drought or flood. It's again one of the wonders of the well. It never dries up.
Mother Shipton's cave is still a tourist attraction. They still charge money to do the nice long walk through the park and then come and marvel at the pool that turns things to stone. But before theme parks, before American roadside attractions, before seaside tourist traps, there was a cave, a good story, and somebody wanted to make some money off it. And they still sell the teddy bears in the gift shop. I got an email from an aquarium, and it changed my mind about aquariums, because biology and zoology never really interested me all that much. For me, somewhere like this, the deep in the city of Hull, wasn't somewhere I'd visit, because yes, important for conservation, vital for science, but it's just some fish, right? But then they sent me an email and asked me if I'd be interested in looking at their life support system. Now, I've only ever heard the words life support system in the context of spaceflight, either realistic, like the oxygen scrubbers and water recyclers on the International Space Station, or in less realistic situations.
Life support systems sustaining on emergency.
But the deep here? It has a life support system.
We are a closed system, so much like your spaceship, we are isolated. There is no input or output to the oceans whatsoever. The water inside that system or exhibit is constantly recirculating between the exhibit and the life support system. So everything that we have here, we have to control, including making our own seawater. The water starts off just as it would in your home out of the tap. Now, the water is very, very hard around here. It's lots of calcium carbonate in the water. So the first thing we have to do is soften it. So that is the removal of that calcium and magnesium ions from the water. So these are full of an ionic resin, and they scavenge those ions out of the water. We don't want calcium to build up in our life support systems, on our heating elements. So what we're left with in this great container over here is roughly 30,000 litres of softened water that has gone through this reverse osmosis machine. It's basically pumping water across a very fine membrane under very high pressure to give us very, very pure water. To that pure water, we then add artificial sea salt. We then pump it around where needed around the building. So this is a really good example of a small scale life support system that we would use for some small standalone tanks like this research system here. Now this has got all the components of a life support system that you would normally find in an aquarium like this. And this is all scaled up on a huge scale for things like our large 2.5 million litre system. What we have at the back here, that's a foam fractionator. So all of these microbubbles that are being injected at the base of this foam fractionator are scavenging organic molecules. Now these molecules and compounds are actually hydrophobic. They don't like water. And what they want to do is they want to adhere to the surface of this microbubble. And they rise to the surface and we then remove them via the cone at the top. This is a biotower. So fish excrete ammonia and urea. Now we have to convert those to less toxic forms. Inside here we have a lot of bioballs. That is a huge, huge surface area. The bacteria that live on these bioballs are converting it through to nitrite, then to nitrate, and we can then complete that process by reducing that to nitrogen gas, which can just off gas into the atmosphere. We've got the sand filtration here. So water enters the top of this unit, it goes through a bed of sand, which scavenges out all those particulates in the water, and then exits the bottom clean. One of the last steps in the life support process is ultraviolet light. It breaks down cell membranes, so we're really looking at antimicrobial action within these units. So water is constantly recirculating between the life support system and the exhibit.
As I talked to the team here, I realised that, sure, you can call this an aquarium, but you could also call it a spaceship for sharks. You've got creatures contained in a higher pressure environment, and okay, it's not the vacuum of space out here, sure, but if these walls are somehow breached, the environment inside will spray out, and if it's not fixed quickly, those fish are dead. And if that environment isn't controlled and maintained constantly and carefully, they're also dead. And that takes a lot more equipment and a lot more precision than you might think.
So just as we have a small foam fractionator on our smaller life support systems, this is the scale of this skimmer on our large system. Now this is part of the building, it's so huge. Now a key part of maintaining this is making sure the mixture of gas is correct that we're pumping into it. So here we have a gas panel. Now this is where we alter the mixture of air and ozone that is going into the super skimmer. So that's helping to break down those organic particles, molecules, so that the skimming can be much more efficient. So we're going down into the heart of the building now, into the basement, and that's where the really large life support equipment is located. Some of which is so large, it forms the fabric of the building itself, and the pipework is built into the ground. So we're now three floors down, and we're only just at the base of the super skimmer. We saw the cone right at the top. Now we're right down at the base, so it just gives you a sense of scale for how big that super skimmer actually is and how much a part of the building it actually is. The water then comes back out of the super skimmer and enters our giant sand filters. We need to remove all the particulates out of the water, those little pieces that you might see floating around, bits of food, things like that. So here we have some very large banks of UV. So water is constantly passing and exposing microbes to that UV light. And then the last step in the process is the huge pumps over there take the water and pump it back into the main exhibit, and we start the whole process over and over again. It happens constantly, and the water is going round and round completely about once every 3 hours. So here we are above our main exhibit, Endless Oceans. Now this is a tropical marine system. It's 2.5 million litres, it's 10 metres deep, and in here is where we keep all of our really key species, including some that are unfortunately now critically endangered in the wild. We do call it a life support system because it is doing exactly that. It is sustaining life. We're controlling every single water parameter in order that the species that we're keeping here are thriving. We are responsible for every single life at the deep.
It is a cold and bleak day here. There are lots of towns and villages around the world that once existed but have been lost to the sea or under floodwaters. But here, on the southeast coast of Britain, there's a village that's still around, but which won't be for too long. Up behind those cliffs is Covehithe. It's a picturesque little village. There's the ruins of a church more than 600 years old, with a more recent church built inside. And by more recent, I mean the little church is only 400 years old. There's farmland, a few houses, a couple of dozen residents. This has been a settlement for at least 1,000 years, possibly more. And it'll be gone by the end of the century. You can see on old maps just how much land has already been lost to the sea. These cliffs here get eroded a little bit with every high tide, steadily being pushed back and back and back. There are warning signs to stop people from walking on top, because the ground near the edge will be loose and could fall with just a little bit of pressure from above. And this has been happening for centuries. It can't go on forever. At some point, no one knows when, the process should stabilise at a new equilibrium, but no one can model that far ahead. For the foreseeable future, the local council's management plan estimates that the coastline will move inland by about 4 or 5 metres every year. There's a lot of margin for error, but even in the best case scenario, Covehithe is gone in 100 years. Worst case, 30 years. It won't actually crumble into the ocean. To avoid pollution, buildings around here are demolished and taken away when the time comes, and presumably someone will have to move the church's graveyard. So why doesn't anyone save Covehithe? The landowners did offer to build their own coastal defences back in 2011 to add breakwaters here as an experiment to see if the erosion could be slowed, but they were turned down by the council. This beach where they need to build is owned by the government, and the government said no. because the needs of the many outweigh the needs of the few. A little way down the coast is Southwold, home to 1,000 people and a lot of tourism. And the simulations say that if Cove Hyde stops eroding, then Southwold would probably start. Or at least they'd need much, much stronger defences. It's not practical to save every building everywhere. This is miles of coastline, and they need to defend all of it, constantly, into eternity. The council's plan is clear. It is not considered sustainable to attempt to manage the erosion. I did ask both the landowners and the council for a comment, but neither got back to me, perhaps because Cove Hyde isn't a tourist attraction, and I don't think they'd want to be. There are no amenities for visitors, there's no little tea shop by the beach, but if you do happen to be somewhere in the area in the next few years, it might be worth stopping by to see Cove Hyde, while you can. Most of us at some point in our lives have abandoned a project halfway through, but most of us don't have that abandoned project sitting on full permanent display to the world. This is the Road to Nowhere in Yate, in southwest England. Let's go for a walk. This is 400 metres of never-completed 1970s highway that goes from a roundabout to, well, nowhere. It's cut off by a railway line. I'm actually a little bit amazed that I only just found out about this, because half-completed Road to Nowhere with lane markings and curbs and everything is very much the sort of thing that I expect younger me to have filmed 5 years ago. And this place is not a secret. This is a big public common. There's folks walking their dogs here. The public can't drive on this road, though. It's gated off. If you look at aerial photos, you can see where it was meant to go. There's another roundabout a little way over there that it would have connected to, completing a small ring road around the town. And you can see exactly what the plan was. It just never happened. And yes, there are a lot of complaints about the traffic in this town. Also on those aerial photos, some heavy equipment and a fake bridge being built just down there. See, this road does have a use. The local council makes it available for filming. The whole area is closed occasionally for television shows to shoot on, and they can make it look like either a small country road or a big highway, depending on where they point their camera. Broadchurch used careful angles and one composite shot to make it look like a coast road, and Hospital Drama Casualty have shot quite a few things here over the 36 years they've been in production. That includes their most expensive scenes ever, which involve a huge fake bridge, crashing vehicles, adding a CGI town around the road, and setting off an enormous tanker explosion. For all it costs, it's actually a little bit underwhelming. Maybe that was a creative decision, maybe it looks more realistic that way. And it's convincing enough. This is an accidental film set. At some point, some British studio would probably have built one of these anyway, it just wouldn't look as good. So the question is, why did this happen? According to one former local councillor, it's because the price of steel suddenly went up. The council didn't want to pay that much for the railway bridge over there, so they put the whole thing on hold, and no one ever started the project up again afterwards. There are still occasional vague political calls to complete it, but I would be very surprised if there's any traffic other than stunt drivers and dog walkers on the Road to Nowhere anytime soon. Welcome to Foulness Island. The name is unfortunate. It either meant muddy headland or possibly bird headland a few centuries ago. It's about 9 square miles, around 150 people who live on it, but unless you are one of those people or you've got business with them, you will not be allowed in. Most of the island, and importantly, the road and bridge that get you onto it, they're owned by the British military and they will turn you away. But despite having no business here, I am on the island, legally. And that's because I didn't use the road and bridge. I walked along a very different path to get here. The Broom Way has been called the most dangerous, most deadly path in Britain. It goes back at least 600 years. And the only reason that I walked here safely is because I had a guide. A few miles back, before we set off, I asked him a few questions.
Historically, there is reportedly 60 to 100 casualties on the Broom Way. The main thing is the tides. It whips round from the North Sea and sort of would come from, not as you expect it, sort of straight on from the horizon, but it'll often spiral in to the coastline, and so it'll cut you off from your pathway. It's very easy to get lost out on the Broom Way, particularly in low visibility conditions when it's raining or there's low fog early morning, late at night. As there's no features or markers to take your bearing from, you can get very quickly disorientated. Quite often people will naturally walk further out to sea as opposed to back to land. The Broom Way is only open at the weekends for the public. The MOD use this as an active firing range, and they have done since the late 1800s. And so one thing that we might see out there is leftover ordnance. They do a pretty good job of cleaning up after themselves, but it doesn't mean that we won't see any out there. I've seen shells sort of this big. You just have to really keep your distance. Shell craters are also a problem because of the exploded ordnance that have gone off. So it's essentially quicksand. And so there'll be pockets of sand which are really soft and mushy that your feet will sink into that we have to be careful of. I only guide walks when the tide is constantly going out. So we are 3 hours after high tide. The tide is still on its way out and we should be coming back here as the tides are turning.
So obviously we made it. Thank you, Tom. The path's called the Broom Way because back before the military built their bridge, back when it was the only access onto this island, it was marked by brooms every 30 metres or so. Now, to 21st century people, that implies like broom handles sticking out the ground. But no, I tracked down a photo from 1922 and the brooms were just short lumps of brush. But over the last century, those brooms stopped being maintained. They were either swept away or eroded. And now the path is unmarked, but it's still on the map. It's still a legal path. Permanently closing a right-of-way in Britain is difficult.
On Foulness, there are public right-of-way footpaths that we can access. They are rarely used, and so if you do take them, the security switchboards will light up because you'll get reported by MOD staff or by locals who live there because they think you're trespassing. I wouldn't be guiding this if I wasn't a qualified mountain leader who has map and compass skills, good experience of this guided walk that I do. I have first aid qualifications, so I know how to sort of deal and treat with the likely emergencies that could happen out here.
That article from 1922 also names some of the people who died on the path. Several doctors travelling to attend patients, young women trying to reach partners, and island residents who got careless or who would sometimes stay in the mainland pubs too late and then try to race the tide back on a galloping horse. Because the part of the Broomway we walked isn't just a footpath. Under modern law, it is a byway open to all traffic, which means that in theory, you can take a horse or a tractor or anything that's road legal onto it. It would be a very, very bad idea to just drive onto the sands, but in theory, you could if you didn't get bogged down. Now, a few times a year, the village on the island and the main road are open for tourism, but not right now, not in 2020, which means that right now, there is only one way for the average person to get onto Foulness Island. But there are two ways to leave. We could go off the rights of way, trespass onto military land, and then very soon after get escorted off by soldiers, assuming we weren't arrested. Or we could just walk back. Ready when you are. This is the Ruhr Valley in Germany, and it used to be a mining region. It used to produce huge amounts of anthracite, and that altered the way that rainwater drains, in that it starts to drain towards where people live. So yesterday, I got to visit one of the pumping stations that puts the water back where it's supposed to be.
The problem is that we have coal mining in this area since 1850, and because of this, the landscape has sunk down, and so we had to pump the whole river Boyle up 18 meters to the river Emscher. And the river Emscher is flowing to the Rhine. In my operational areas, we have about 60 pump stations, from a very small station with a few hundred liters to this station with 40,000 liters per second. 83 square kilometers is our operational area, this one station. From my operational area, nearly 60% would be flooded if the whole pump stations wouldn't work. If you have dry conditions, it would be 4 to 5 days. In heavy rain conditions, only 5 hours, the water will get out.
Just to be clear, those pumps are moving a whole river, a small river, but a whole river, 18 meters up and through massive underground pipes, so the water can then join a bigger river that does eventually flow to the sea. There are around 180 pumping stations, large and small, across this valley. That one station is the largest. After a heavy storm, it will move up to 40,000 litres of water every second. If you look at articles about this, they'll sometimes mention groundwater and aquifers, but the engineers here told me that is wrong. It is probably a mistranslation. These are storm drains to deal with rainwater.
The coal mining companies are paying for this because they had dig the coal, and because of this, the landscape is sunk down, so they have to pay for.
When coal mining started here 150 years ago, no one thought about the land sinking. And when they did notice it, which was somewhere around 1900, it didn't stop them mining, they just built the first pumps. The coal was worth the money and the trouble then. But running the pumps is an eternal cost. Not technically eternal, I guess, but this won't go away in 100 or 1,000 or 10,000 years. Not until something equally dramatic and geological comes along to reshape the land. If people want to live in the Ruhr Valley, not the Ruhr Swamp or the Ruhr Lake, then the pumps must run. A few months ago, I went to Zwentendorf in Austria, which is a nuclear power plant that was built and ready to go and then cancelled. And it's now a training centre and accidental museum because, well, what else would you do with a never-used nuclear power plant?
This is Wunderland Kalka. It's a theme park opened in 2001. Each year we got about 280,000 visitors here in the park. The Dutch entrepreneur Van der Mos, he bought this in 1996. And from that time on, the first 4 or 5 years, we just put everything out of it and start to rebuild the whole area till what it is now.
This was SNR 300. And its story is much the same as Zwentendorf's. It was a nuclear power plant ready to go in Germany. And then public protests and political problems meant that the whole project was postponed for a long, long while. And then Chernobyl happened in the Ukraine, and the tide of public opinion changed even further. And the whole project was just cancelled. The reactor itself, all the valuable stuff in there, well, that was sold off for parts and for scrap. But the land, well, that was sold off in the 90s.
What we've got now is a theme park with approximately 40 attractions. Of course, there's a carousel, there are the teacups, the elephants, and there's also a very nice roller coaster in the park. One of the important things we've got is in the cooling tower, that's the vertical swing. We've got an hotel with 1,000 beds, and we've got a big exhibition hall with 9,000 square meters where you can have all kinds of exhibitions. Two-thirds of the buildings at the moment are still empty. For example, the building behind of us was the reactor building. The reactor building, it's nothing in it at the moment, but we want to make a new landscape in it with all kinds of well.